Well, the focus remains very much on the market. Exit polls suggest that Modi will return as Prime Minister, and on the back of that expectation, we've seen the Nifty and the Sensex, as well as the Bank Nifty, hit record high levels. In fact, several large waves really driving the action, hitting life highs themselves. The question, though, at this point is, will the rally continue until 23rd of May, as well as beyond 23rd of May? How will the markets perform on Thursday? Well, to answer these questions, let's bring in Deepak Jasani, Head of Retail Research at HDFC Securities, to give us an outlook then for the markets. Welcome, Deepak. Very good to have you on. And what a rally we've seen, you know, the largest intraday rally that we've seen in a decade or so as far as the benchmarks go. And of course, we've seen individual stocks hit their life highs, the best day ever coming in for the Bank Nifty. Obviously, it's a big thumbs up that the market has given to these exit bulls. But let me, you know, get a slightly near-term expectation from you. In the run-up, next couple of days, 23rd of May, what would the market be watching for in terms of the election outcome? What would the market read as a confirmation? What would it read as a disappointment?
Yeah, good morning, Nivedita. Over the next 2 days, or maybe till Thursday, end of the day, markets, in terms of the election outcome, will look at actually how many seats that BJP has won and how many seats NDA has won. So now, in case BJP by itself gets a big majority, maybe more than 280 seats, then that would be one more positive booster, sentiment booster for the time being. Secondly, the markets will also look at what is the vote share of BJP in the southern states. Now, there the party is not expected to do too well, but whether the vote share has inched up at all or not, or region-wise, how has BJP become more popular or not. And in the eastern side, what has happened to BJP or NDA in the states of West Bengal and Odisha. So this in terms of number of seats won and in terms of vote share. So I think broadly these two or three things will be watched very carefully by the markets, and then they will discount this the outcome based on how these are interpreted.
You know, one interesting trend that we've seen, at least in the first day of trade since these exit polls came out, is that the nature of the rally is very, very broad-based indeed. You know, we're seeing mid-caps participating, small caps coming back, and these are the ones that have been lagging, not just, you know, for the last 6 months or so, but even beyond that for the last couple of years. What is the expectation that you see in terms of what will drive the action? Will the focus remain on the large caps, you know, the ones that have been leading the way from the front, or are there some unexpected, you know, gainers that you expect? Perhaps many of the areas that have been beaten down, let's say metals, autos, mid and small caps, do you expect these to come in from behind?
So here we are talking about post Thursday. Now typically what has happened in the past after the elections that the post election time has coincided with the global upswing in economy. Now this time around I think there is an issue or a problem there. So there, that is one bit of a caution out here. Secondly, in 2014 the FIIs invested $2 billion roughly in each of the 3 months of May, June and July. That was big inflow, consistent inflow in 3 months post the elections. Now this time around I think so far they have been net sellers of some 5,000 odd crores, compensated by mutual fund inflows. So to that extent we will have to see resurrection of FII flows for a repeat of what has happened in the past elections. Now within the segments of large cap and mid and small caps, I think initially the focus would remain on the large caps, because that is where the inflows from the FIIs and domestic mutual funds will be concentrated, although the whole street is quite bullish on small and mid cap stocks doing quite well. But I think we will have to wait and be a little more patient for those small and mid caps to perform. The mid-cap index, incidentally, vis-a-vis the Nifty, is now at a low since 2012, so which shows the kind of underperformance that the mid-cap space has shown so far. But I think once the large caps have seen a decent amount of uprun and traders have made a good amount of money trading in them, then probably the focus could shift towards the better managed mid and small caps. Now again, there we should be very careful about what kind of stocks we are looking at or investing in, because the last one and a half years has been very painful if you blindly invested in mid and small caps. So you will have to be a little more careful about the quality of the company, about whether the company will be able to overcome the disruption that is seen across, whether in terms of regulation, technology, liquidity, etc., etc. So there a little more caution is required, but net-net, yes, mid and small caps, 1 year down the line will outperform the large caps, but your entry point should be a little fine-tuned.
Absolutely. So we will expect the large caps to drive the action at least near term, but we can't rule out that there will be the catch-up rally from the space that has been the most heavily beaten down and resulted possibly in the largest loss of wealth for retail investors so far. That is the small and the mid caps. But talking about the frontline names or the large caps, what is the view, Deepak, on financials? Because it's a very tricky time period at this point. If you go by the bank Nifty, we're sitting at life highs for this one. But the kind of concerns that existed around the PSU banking space, the expectations of recoveries that haven't quite played out, that story hasn't really changed. Where would you be coming in if we talk about the banks first, on private banks and PSU banks? And of course, after that, what would you be doing with NBFCs at this point? Because things are looking fairly concerning for that space.
Sure. Now, private banks continue to be in favor, but I think you have to restrict your expectation in terms of returns from them. You may get your 12 to 15 or 18% return maybe year on year in case of private banks. Now, if you want to sort of look at other segments like PSU banks or financials or NBFCs for that matter, then one will have to sort of closely watch as to how the cabinet berths are sort of being filled, who is being appointed in crucial cabinets or departments. And what are the initial policy pronouncements from the government in terms of boosting liquidity, bringing down interest rates and speeding up the IBC process. I think these three things will be crucial for PSU Bank. Now, PSU banks have other set of problems in terms of corporate governance, in terms of their compensation structures and in terms of the need for consolidation. So, what are the pronouncements of the government in terms of all this will have to be closely watched. But all said and done, I think the larger PSU banks are looking good in the near term from a trading perspective. Whether that can be converted into investment will depend on the policy pronouncements over the next one and a half months once the government sets in.
What about NBFCs?
And similar is the case with NBFCs.
Right.
Similar is the case with NBFCs. There again, we need some liquidity infusion, some relief on provisioning. But at the same time, let us not sort of brush all the problems under the carpet. Now, that is a very easy thing to do. Now, those, if you do that, then 6 months, 12 months down the line, the same problems will crop up and in a bigger manner. So, we will have to be very careful in dealing with NBFC situations. So, there, the quality, one will have to segment between the different qualities, the pedigrees of the NBFCs, the ones which have 10-20 years of history and are conservative, and the others who have sort of come up over the last 5-7 years and have been a little reckless in their business practices. Some sort of a liquidity relief and provisioning relief will have to be provided to them, depending on the categorization in which they are. And post that, I think there could be a slow recovery in that sector too.
All right. In fact, let me get a few names from you. It does seem, at least, like you're pointing out, that it does. It depends on the regulatory environment for banks, for NBFCs. That will really dictate the direction these stocks take going forward. But if you're talking about, the kind of pedigree names in the industry, about 20, 25 years experience, I can imagine it would be the likes of the HDFC twins, the Bajaj Finance twins as well. What else are you liking from this space, or are you keeping the focus entirely on these ones?
Among the NBFCs, I think a few names that you mentioned, I think the others are, I think, Chola with pedigree, maybe Sundaram Finance out there, and a few others. I think initially one should concentrate on the better pedigree, the better known quality stocks. And later on, when we think that the sector is giving the is being given the necessary reliefs, then one can sort of move towards the second quality stocks for a quick participation in the up move. So there again, you will have to sort of keep taking your profits, fast profits, and then keep reviewing whether the second quality companies are changing or mending their ways, or they are going back to their original ways. So that will have to be crucially watched.
All right. You know, we spoke about financials, Deepak, but just a final question. Are you expecting some kind of churn as far as the sectors go? Where do you think, you know, we'll see the leadership coming from as far as sectoral action is concerned? And you also mentioned being very selective and being very careful as far as trying to play the recovery in the mid and small caps are concerned. Which would be the names on your list?
Now, yeah, in terms of sectors, I think we have been bullish for the last few months on PSU and capital goods or industrials, as they are called. So basically, whenever a new election is going to happen, there are a lot of expectation build up in terms of policies which will affect these two sectors the most. So here again, from in the near term, over the next 2 to 3 months or maybe 6 months, these two sectors could continue to perform. Apart from that, I think select consumer space. Now, overall, the consumer space is still quite expensive, and monsoon uncertainty is ahead of us. So, in that sense, we have to be selective among the consumer space, whether it is retail, whether it is paints, packaged foods, or even aviation for that matter. Insurance is another sector which can be looked at on significant dips. And of course, we talked about financials. So broadly, these are the sectors I think which we continue to like over the, in the near term, and as well as over the next 1 year period.
And the mid and small caps, so any specific names that you can leave us with?
Now again, mid and small caps, for example, let me give you an example. We came out with reports on Siemens and GE Power. So both are part of industrials. They are a little expensive in terms of P, but there is no question on their corporate governance, on their technology achievements, on their growth in terms of the segments where they are placed. So these two are come to my mind immediately in terms of industrials. So these are some stocks which we like.
Deepak, we leave it at that. Thanks so much for joining in. A pleasure speaking to you. A lot of focus on where the market direction will take us going forward from here. We are expecting large caps to continue to lead. That's the view coming in from Deepak Jasani. But you can't rule out that we'll see that recovery finally come in for the broader end of the market as well. But let's put the focus then on